until the arrival of COVID-19. Nothing could be further from the truth. Ghanaians want relief from the socio-economic pain and hardship visited on them by the MPP administration and not flimsy excuses. Ghanaians want a government that will be truthful, even in difficult times, and listen to them in humility. Incontrovertible facts show that Ghana's economy showed signs of serious challenges even before COVID-19 struck, a point that was made by the country director of the World Bank, Mr. Pierre Laporte. For instance, way before the first case of COVID-19 was recorded in Ghana in March 2020, the public debt had increased from $120 billion in 2016 to $225 billion in 2019, representing an increase of $105 billion in the country's debt stock. COVID was nowhere. Ukraine and Russia had not even thought about fighting. Our debt to GDP ratio had increased from 56% in 2016 to about 70% in 2019. That is including the ESLA, DACHI, and other hidden debts. Before COVID-19, the debt servicing amount had increased from $11 billion in 2016 to $37 billion in 2019 and constituted 91% of tax revenue. There was no COVID, no Ukraine and Russia, and the Queen was still alive, and no earthquake in Turkey. Also, the budget deficit had exceeded the legally acceptable threshold of 5% and had hit 7.5% in 2018 and 7% in 2019. There was no COVID. Again, before COVID-19, the Ghana CD in 2019 was plummeting in double digits, leading to the setting up of a 40-member committee by the government to investigate the causes of the alarming depreciation of the national currency. Surprisingly, the committee excluded the chairman of the economic management team, a move described by many analysts as a vote of no confidence in the competence of His Excellency Vice President Mahmoudou Bawumia by his own government. In fact, per paragraph 61 of this government's own 2020 mid-year budget review statement, and I beg to quote, in the year to December 2019, the Ghana CD cumulative depreciated by 12.9% against the US dollar, compared with 8.4% depreciation in 2018. Against the British pound and euro, the Ghana CD cumulatively depreciated by 15.7% and 12% respectively, compared with 3.3% and 3.9% over the same period in 2018, unquote. Far from being the cause of economic collapse, COVID-19, in fact, brought the Akufo-Addo Bawumia government an unprecedented windfall of about 30 billion Ghana cedis to manage and mitigate the impact of the pandemic. Unfortunately, this was largely wasted on election-related expenses. This amount excludes proceeds from the obnoxious COVID-19 levy, which Ghanaians continue to pay till date. My brothers and sisters, according to the Auditor General, only 11.7% of this amount was spent on government COVID-19, with the remainder of about 18 billion being channeled into so-called budget support. There is no gainsaying the fact that the coronavirus pandemic affected all countries in the world, including our next door neighbors, Benin, Togo, Cote d'Ivoire, Burkina Faso, and Nigeria. Whereas these countries manage their resources prudently, thereby recording deficits below 8% and debt-to-GDP ratios of below 65%, the Akufo-Addo Bawumia government borrowed excessively and spent recklessly for election purposes, thereby recording a disastrous deficit of 15.7% and a debt-to-GDP ratio of about 80% in 2020. It is instructive to note that in the year 2020, when COVID was at its peak, all our neighbors recorded a budget deficit of less than 8%. Burkina Faso recorded a deficit of 5.7%. Cote d'Ivoire recorded a deficit of 5.6%. Nigeria recorded a deficit of 5.8%. And Senegal recorded a deficit of 6.4%. But Ghana alone recorded a deficit of 15.7% because of the reckless election-driven expenses and wastage the Akufo-Addo Bawumia MPP government engaged in. My brothers and sisters, did COVID-19 affect Ghana any more than it did to our neighbors? How come none of these countries who were all affected by the pandemic are recording double-digit deficits and high debt-to-GDP ratio of over 100%? How come none of these countries are recording inflation rates of over 50% like Ghana? How come none of this has defaulted on their debt repayments? How can none of them has been downgraded to junk status and have been locked out of the international capital market? How come none of these countries are going through a domestic debt restructuring? How come none of these countries are visiting cruel financial haircuts on their citizens, including pensioners? How come none of these countries are experiencing childhood vaccine shortages? To paraphrase Dr. Bawumia, how did COVID-19 jump over Nigeria, Benin, Cote d'Ivoire, and other neighbors of ours to attack and destroy only Ghana's economy? Ladies and gentlemen, the truth of the matter is that the economic mess we have on our hands has largely been brought about by the reckless spending, excessive borrowing, and crash economic mismanagement by the Bawumia-led economic management team, and not any external factors as government will have us believe. The last thing that is required in time of crisis is a leader whose words ring hollow and who cannot be trusted. In truth, Akufo-Addo has proven Stephen Levinsky right when he wrote in his famous book, How Democracies Die. And this was what he said. Quote, "For a demagogue who feels besieged by critics and shackled by democratic institutions, crisis opens a window of opportunity to silence critics and weaken rivals. Indeed, elected autocrats often need crisis. External threats offer them a chance to break free, both swiftly and very often legally." Unquote. During this crisis, nothing the president says can be believed because everything he has said has proven to be untrue. Ghanaians have come to realize that the claim by the president that he knew how to revive a dead economy was a scam. Quote, "We are a proud nation. We are not going to IMF," was a scam. There will be no haircuts. What's a scam? The promise to build 88 district hospitals within a year. What's a scam? Agenda 111 project. What's a scam? The promise to abolish road tolls. What's a scam? The promise to convert toll booths into modern, ultra-modern public toilets on our highways. They claim that there was a global shortage of childhood vaccines. What's a scam? No state funds will finance the National Cathedral. What's a scam? Designed to fleece the state by the likes of Reverend Victor Kusi Boateng or Kwabena Adujemfi, whichever sounds better to you. David Ajayi and Kerry Summers. Ladies and gentlemen, another deliberate falsehood peddled by the president in his infamous address was the claim that his government has constructed more NCA licensed fiber optic cables than any other government in the Fourth Republic. We submit that the total of 93% of fiber optic cables the president claimed credit for constitute the greatest telecom scam ever. At least the MPP must give credit to the NDC for providing the 900-kilometer Eastern Corridor fiber optic network running from Ho to Boku with a link from Yendi to Tamale and an extension to the campus of the University of Health and Allied Sciences. The 300-kilometer Accra Tema Metro fiber, the wireless broadband of 119 4G LTE base station to power the Gota phone system. And let me add, the Ministry of Communication, the National Data Center, the Accra Digital Center, and the National Communications Authority are all housed by NDC constructed edifices. When a president constantly shows such blatant dishonesty, it crashes the accountability mechanism. My brothers and sisters, let me now turn to another very important topic, corruption. President Akufo-Addo's silence on corruption in his infamous address was very loud. It was as loud as his guilt. Evidently, corruption has defeated his family and friends' government. Instead of confronting this canker head-on, President Akufo-Addo has constituted himself into a corruption-clearing agent, ever willing to whitewash himself and any of his appointees who dabble in corruption, even before investigative processes commence. The president's action and complicity have emboldened many of his officials, not least his vice president, Alhaji Bawumia, whose name has come up in multiple corruption scandals, such as the PDS scandal, the shady gold for oil deal, the stolen rice scandal, and the famous appearance fee scandal. My brothers and sisters, President Akufo-Addo's misguided declaration that nothing dishonorable was done with the COVID funds adds to the litany of failed attempts to conceal the rot that has left many scandalized following the publication of the special audit report in COVID-19 funds by the Auditor General of Ghana. First, it was the Attorney General pretending to take umbrage to the publication of the report. Then comes the Chief Corruption Clearing Agent himself, even before The said report is considered by Parliament. How does President Akufo-Addo reasonably expect Ghanaians to accept as honorable the Auditor General's finding that COVID-19-related payments totaling more than 543 million Ghana cedis were made to various service providers outside of the Ghana Integrated Financial Management Information System in clear violation of Regulation 61 of the Public Financial Management Regulation 2019, LI 2378. How? How about the Auditor General's finding that medical equipment valued at nearly US$250,000, which were procured with COVID funds and subsequently issued to some specific health facilities, did not reach these health facilities? How? Mr. President, I put it to you that there is everything dishonorable with the finding by the Auditor General that a company known as Modern Security Printers Limited, which was awarded a contract to conduct public education on COVID-19 safety protocols for students at an outrageous cost of 1.5 million Ghana cedis, has been paid in full for no work done. I further put it to you, Mr. President, that there is everything dishonorable with the damning finding by the Auditor General that cash payments totaling almost 12 million Ghana cedis to caterers who provided hot meals during the 3 weeks of partial lockdown were all retired with honor certificates instead of receipts, and that other COVID-19 related payments to caterers totaling 5.6 million Ghana cedis were neither backed by receipts nor honor certificates. Again, I put it to you, Mr. President, that the government management of COVID-19 funds cannot be said to be honorable when the Auditor General could not verify bills and validate dubious payments amounting to 37.6 million Ghana cedis by the Minister of Finance to NGOs and private individual water provided for the provision of so-called free water. Also, it is dishonorable for officials of the Kwadwo Opong Nkrumah-led Ministry of Information to line their pockets with COVID funds under the guise of risk allowances meant for frontline health workers. It is the height of cruelty for funds which were meant to save lives during a public health crisis to have been looted and misappropriated in this bizarre manner. Brothers and sisters, despite the desperate attempt by the chief corruption clearing agent to sweep these serious crimes under the carpet, one thing which will tarry for ages to come is how the COVID-19 pandemic became a corruption bonanza and a milking cow for President Akufo-Addo and his officials to cream state resources in the most obscene manner. It should come as little surprise, therefore, that the president has become a clearing agent who actually rewards unscrupulous members of his government with national awards. Instead of the president sacking the serially incompetent Minister for Health, Kwaku Ajimamenu, he decided to confer national honors on the minister's corruption and included even more corrupt appointees and companies to desecrate the revered national award ceremony. Dr. Nkrumah established this national award scheme with the view to honoring people and institutions that have distinguished themselves in service and sacrifice to propel Ghana's growth and development. Mr. President, Our nation's founder, Kwame Nkrumah, did not intend for the National Award Scheme to honor criminality by cleverly sprinkling and sandwiching a few meritorious awardees among nation records. This year's awards and the inclusion of these shady characters, some of whom are under parliamentary inquiry, can at best be viewed as part of the systemic denigration of our statehood. And I'm happy that some decent awardees never participated in such a scheme. It also reveals the weakened and depraved state of our nation, a nation where those who scrutinize government dubious expenditures are chased out of office as auditor generals, the Domelevos of this world. A nation where journalists who unearth corruption are harassed, intimidated, and sometimes murdered, the Ahmed Swalis of this world. A nation where members of parliament who diligently carry out their constitutional mandate of oversight and expose crimes are persecuted. There's Samuel Okudzeto, Ablakwa's and Atufosin's of this world. And a nation where those who fight corruption are fought back and are even described as terrorists by the courts. The Anas, Arimiyau Anas, of this world. On this note, let me urge Ghanaians and the diplomatic community not to be intimidated by the president's unprecedented attack on the German ambassador during his message on the state of the nation in parliament. We urge all true Democrats to join hands with the National Democratic Congress to resist the suppression of free speech by the Akufo-Addo Bawumia MPP government. My brothers and sisters, another example of the corrupt schemes under this government is the Gensha energy deal, which is stifling the Ghana Gas Company and may end up collapsing this monumental NDC legacy project. Under this corrupt deal, the government has decided to allow persons known to be affiliated to the MPP to build a private gas plant so GMPC can sell natural gas from our oil fields to them at one-third the price at which they sell to Ghana Gas, which is state-owned. The whole idea is to cream off hundreds of millions of dollars in unreasonable and supernormal profit into the pockets of the greedy MPP cronies. As chairman of the NDC, I wish to serve notice that we will vigorously oppose this glaring theft of national resources for private gain. Ladies and gentlemen, the NDC believes institutions must work and the standards must even be higher for independent constitutional bodies that are legally clothed with independence to work independently. This is why we in NDC maintain that the Electoral Commission must abandon its intransigence and listen to wise counsel in order to save Ghana's democracy. Why would the EC insist on making the Ghana card the sole document for registration of voters when the National Identity Registration Law allows for the guarantor system as an identification mechanism? Why? In the interest of our democracy and development, the Jim Mensah-led EC should for once agree with the opposition NDC, civil society organizations, and other well-meaning Ghanaians, including the Venerable Dr. Kwadwo Afarijan, Ghana's longest-serving former chairman of the Electoral Commission and foremost authority on electoral issues, who insists that the guarantor system must be maintained in our electoral system. My my brothers and sisters, another reason for Ghana's economic collapse is the expenditure on the bloated size of government. As has been revealed by our hard-working members of parliament, between January and September of 2022, the Akufo-Addo Bawumia presidency wasted the taxpayers' money as follows. The president's operational enhancement expenditure, whatever that means, cost the suffering Ghanaian taxpayer a mind-boggling 59.4 million Ghana cedis. The fuel bills at the president alone cost the taxpayer 51.1 million Ghana cedis. President Akufo-Addo's regional tolls last year cost 16.9 million Ghana cedis. Tires and batteries for official vehicles at the presidency alone cost Ghanaians 15 million Ghana cedis. A cabinet retreat, cabinet meeting outside Accra, cost the taxpayer a colossal 4.8 million Ghana cedis. Payment for new vehicles cost the suffering Ghanaian taxpayer 6.5 million after Nanado had declared that they will not purchase any new vehicles. Payment for networking and ICT equipment cost the Ghanaian taxpayer 6.6 million Ghana cedis. An amount of 10.4 million was spent on the Independence Day celebration in Cape Coast. 10 million for Independence Day celebration. An amount of 4 million was spent by the vice president on so-called emergency activities. Whatever that means, nobody knows. Telecommunications and internet services from January to September alone cost the suffering Ghanaian taxpayer a shocking 20 million cedis. And last but not the least, furniture, expenditure on office furniture and fittings cost 7 million cedis. Further evidence of the waste of scarce resources can be seen in the many needless political appointees at the presidency. In the midst of the worst economic crisis in living memory, the president continues to make ridiculous and superfluous appointments at the presidency, such as the following. Youth ambassador for diaspora affairs. Policy associate. Chief Executive of Public Sector Reforms, Overseer of the National Cathedral, Church Relations Manager, Diaspora Church Mobilization Officer, Policy and Coordinator Analyst, Focal Person, La Francophonie, Technical Director, La Francophonie. Coordinator, Special Development Initiative Secretariat. Director of Special Projects. Manager of Operations and Programs. 5 Technical Communication Assistants. Technical Advisor, Zongo Development Authority. 2 technical advisors, Special Development Initiative Secretariat. Technical advisor, Political Affairs. Presidential staffer, NAPCO. Office Management Executive Associate. Technical director to the Presidential Advisor on Media. And data manager. Enough of this disaster of a government that continues to waste They already battered public purse with reckless abandon. We demand an immediate dismissal of this redundant hangers-on at the presidency. In this regard, we wish to advise the Akufo-Addo-Bawumia MPP government to consider the detailed alternative policy proposals put out by former President John Dramani Mahama in his famous address to the nation on building the Ghana we want, which was delivered in this very auditorium on 27th October 2022. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, we in the NDC love our dear nation, Ghana. We shall neither prize partisan politics above policy nor personal interests above patriotism. Therefore, we shall continue to engage our members of parliament, civil society organizations, religious organizations, organized labor, and all stakeholders to fashion out a viable and sustainable alternative strategy to save Ghana's economy and democracy. Saving our economy also means saving our democracy. So we expect the president to drastically cut down the size of his government to signal a new beginning. We further expect the government to be tolerant to dissent, heed the calls for implementation of the Constitutional Review Committee recommendations, eschew profligacy, desist from nepotism and corruption, sanction corrupt officials, and be honest about the true state of the nation. My brothers and sisters, it is obvious that President Akufo-Addo, who continues to reveal in the largesse of high office, does not appreciate the present day reality of the Ghanaian people. The president continues to live in his own world, far removed from yours and mine, that he fails or neglects to appreciate the true state of the nation. It is absolutely important to awaken President Akufo-Addo and the ruling MPP to the uncomfortable but frank true state of Ghana today. A nation of many living in fear of where to find their next meal, leaving many parents to endure sleepless nights. The true state of our dear nation no longer lies in flowery speeches laced with political chicanery that never accept responsibility for anything. Neither does it lie in the abstract theories that blame personal feelings on events that have no significant impact on our lives. The true state of the nation is when a ball of kenke, which used to sell between 50 pesos and 1 cedi in December 2016, is now being sold for between 4 cedis and 5 cedis. The true state of Ghana is that a sack of maize, which used to sell for 170 cedis in 2016, is now being sold for 900 cedis as at February 2023. The true state of the nation is where a bag of Gino rice, 5 kilos, which used to go for 25 cedis in December 2016, is now being sold for 185 cedis. Similarly, a tuber of yam, which used to sell for 5 cedis, is now being sold for 25 cedis. While a bag of sachet water, which used to sell for 1 cedi, 50 pesos, in 2016, is now being sold for 10 cedis as at February 2023. Also, a bag of cement, which sold for 27 cedis in December 2016, is today selling at a staggering 90 cedis. And last but not the least, even sanitary pad, which used to sell for 2 cedis 50 pesos in December 2016, is today selling for 20 cedis. When everything is said and done, this is the true state of our nation, Ghana. This is what we feel when we go to the market. This is what we feel in our pockets. This is our everyday reality. A reality in which babies do not have vaccines, leading to a measles outbreak. The youth do not have jobs. The middle class faces imminent extinction. The elderly are being deprived of their life savings by the very government that swore to protect them. This is not the Ghana we deserve. This is not the Ghana our forebears toiled and sacrificed for. The NDC shall not be complicit in this mess. We are determined to work assiduously with the Ghanaian people through our superior patriotic policy alternatives and impressive track record to rescue our dear nation from the abyss. We are certain, with God on our side, we shall succeed. Thank you very much, and may God bless our homeland, Ghana.
Shall we give our national chairman another rousing round of applause? And while at it, Mr. Soundman, get ready to play Yanarai Asasini. Please, shall we resume our seats? We shall sing that before we leave the auditorium. Wow, what a speech. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe you would agree with me that address you just listened to reflects accurately the true state of our dear nation. Thank you very much, our national chairman and leader, for that brilliant presentation. I don't know what the key highlights were for you, but for me, the key highlight was a statement the national chairman made that hopelessness, recklessness, corruption, and leadership paralysis define the current state of our nation. And then the one which I'm sure all of us will not forget as we leave this auditorium. He says, Ghanaians have come to realize that the claim by the president that he knew how to revive a dead economy was what? The claim that we are a proud nation and that we were never going to go to the IMF was what? The promise by the president that there will be no haircuts was also what? The promise to build 88 district hospitals within 1 year was what? The Agenda 1-1 hospital project was what? The promise to abolish road tolls was what? The promise to convert toll booths into ultra-modern public toilets was what? And the claim that there was a global shortage of childhood vaccines was what? Thank you very much. Let's give our national chairman another round of applause. Now, I want to once again acknowledge all the media networks who are streaming live this very important program on their channels. In Bunu East, we've been live on Akina Radio, Winners FM, Zone FM, Atobu FM, Fabia FM. In the Western North region, we've been live on Akwaba FM. In the Bono region, the region of the national chairman, we've been live on Tyne FM and Estroma FM. In Upper West, we've been live on Home Radio. We've been live on Radford FM, WFM, Golu FM, Tumpani FM, and Radio Mark. In the Western region, we'll be live on Sharp FM, Radio 360 FM, Empire FM, Spice FM, Western Radio, Royal FM, Abimpa FM and Trinity FM. In Savannah, we've been live on Inkligi FM, Kasha FM, and Magic FM. Again, I want to recognize some of the leading members that I didn't initially recognize, leading members of the NDC. I see a man who is a mentor to some of us and a guide, Uncle Tutubiko Kwachi, is here. A round of applause for him. We also have another leading member, Mr. Idiana, is here. A round of applause for him. Honorable Sylvester Tete is here. Oh, and then we have one of the aspirants in the presidential primaries of the great NDC here. Dr. Kwame Nadofo is here. A round of applause for him. Yes, yes. And then we have all of you here. A round of applause for yourselves. I want to specially recognize the team that worked hard to make this program possible. We recognize the contribution of Comrade Joseph Mukhtari Bauer, Comrade Stan Dugby, Dr. Mane Buama, my brother Felix Ofosu Kwachi, Uncle Tutubi Kwachi, my sister Ububia Dakon, and our General Secretary, Honorable Fifi Kwete. But let me especially, very, very specially, recognize the support the NDC Minority Caucus, led by Dr. Atoforsin, gave to this program. This program was made possible by their support. I'm sure we've all enjoyed the exceptional and brilliant presentations they have made on the so-called seat of the nation address that was presented by President Akufo-Addo to Parliament. Haven't we? They've done excellently well. A round of applause for our MPs. Mr. Soundman, is the sound ready? Okay, so before we take the closing prayer, shall we rise on our feet and sing Yenara Asasini?
Yenara Asasini, Ea Bodhini Maye, Mojena Nananum Shebu Nyanito Maye, Nidumini Wososo, Seyebe Yenbetosu, Inyo Jasu Koto Kani, Yapasebi Kuminya, Edi Yenbe Muta Maye, Nesasi Muta Atum Se, Omanu Sebe Yeyo,
thank you very much. We started with a Christian prayer, and so we will end with a Muslim prayer. Comrade Ibrahim, can you come to the stage and give us that Muslim prayer? For our friends in the media here, we'll plead with you to give us a few minutes. When we close, we'll be with you and make sure you get the speech which was delivered before you leave. And so let's rise to our feet and take the closing prayer before we depart. Okay, he says we can sit down. Thank you.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Let's pray. Haka lillahi wa lahu la sharika la wa ashadu anna Muhammad abduhu wa rasulahu lahu al-mulku wa lahu al-hamdu yuhyi wa yumitu wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir huwa al-awwal wa al-akhir wa zahir wa batin wa kulli shay'in alim rabbana atina fid dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azaban nar rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahma innaka antal wahhab bismillahir rahmanir rahim الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين.
All right, so ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the great NDC, we'd like to thank all of you for coming. For the media who may want to grant post-event interviews, we have our ranking members here. Honorable Isaac Adongo is here, our ranking member, our Minority Caucus leadership are here. Our communicators are here. Feel free to speak to any of them. Thank you very much for coming. Mr. DJ, you can give us music. Thank you.
get you a coffee, don't worry. I'll get you a coffee, not this one.